transportation of gases. What are the gases? Oxygen and carbon dioxide. So we know very well that we will inhale the oxygen and we will exhale the carbon dioxide. So how the blood can able to take this oxygen towards the tissues, and from the tissues how it is bringing back the carbon dioxide to the lungs for the elimination. So now in this topic we will go to different types of things, how our body can able to adjust and what are the respiratory volumes we will see. First, transportation of gases. Okay, so here in this topic we will see now about oxygen transport. In this oxygen transport you can see the curves here in the dotted lines. We will see once again here. First, we will start with transport of oxygen. So here you know 3% it is transported through plasma. 3% it is transported through plasma, and 97% it is transported with hemoglobin. It is transported with hemoglobin and 3% with plasma. So here what is playing important role? Here partial pressure is very important. What is this? Partial pressure plays important role. So how much partial pressure is there in lungs? That is, in lungs oxygen partial pressure is 104 mmHg pressure is there. In lungs, in previous class we discussed about these pressures. So now in lungs how much partial pressure is there about oxygen? 104. So at that time hemoglobin can able to bind with oxygen. Total how many oxygen molecules are there? 4 oxygen molecules can able to bind with hemoglobin. Generally hemoglobin is tetramer, which is made with 4 polypeptide chains. In this 4 polypeptide chains the ferrous group is there. This ferrous group is able to catch the oxygen. So like that 4 oxygen molecules are going to attach to 1 hemoglobin. So like that hemoglobin can able to carry 4 oxygen atoms. So now it is called oxyhemoglobin. That is, so like that which one playing important role means here in the lungs this reaction is happening, that is at 104 mmHg partial pressure, that is especially with oxygen this reaction is going on. And one more thing, here oxygen pressure is there, but what about the situation of carbon dioxide? Also we will discuss pressure of carbon dioxide. Here the pressure of carbon dioxide is only just 40 mmHg. How much it is? Just 40 mmHg. How much oxygen? 104 mmHg. So who is dominating? Oxygen is dominating. So automatically oxygen easily binds with hemoglobin. At the same time carbon dioxide is very less, the temperature is also less, pH is normal. You can see in these dotted lines, I want to mention it clearly, the upper line what you are observing, this is all about the thing which is happening in the lungs. Okay, in lungs what is that? You see the very much saturation you can see. So this is all about 104 pressure of O2, 40 pressure of CO2, and at the same time same things we have to plot here. temperature is less, pH is normal. In this such situations, you can see 97% in this situation, 97% of, okay, in this situation, 97% of hemoglobin is going to get saturated with the hemoglobin. Okay, so now the pressure of O2, we can see here, is very high. Now, when this is going to get into the tissues, you can see, here we can see about the tissues. The graph is coming down, the graph is moving towards the right side. Which side it is moving? Which is moving towards the right side. Okay, what is this? This is right side. Towards x-axis, we can also call towards x-axis, the graph is moving. So, what is going to happen in the tissues? Same thing, we will move from lungs to tissues. In the tissue, the situation is reverse. Pressure of oxygen is only just 40 mmHg. Here it was 104, but when coming to the tissue, it was 40. Here, pressure of carbon dioxide is more. That is 45 mmHg. So, here who is dominating in the tissue? Carbon dioxide is dominating in the tissue. So, like that, here you can see I am writing pressure of CO2 is 45. But pressure of O2 is just 40. So, that's why whatever the high situation is there in the graph, that is coming down. Right. So, here the pressure of, you see this graph is moving towards that side in the tissues. So, automatically, where the temperature is high and also carbon dioxide pressure is high and pH value is low. pH value is low means H plus ions concentration is more. H plus ions are more. Here, okay, pH is normal. That is almost normal pH means low pH means H plus ions also. Here the pressure normal means high. That is high pressure means H plus ions are very less. So, this is the situation you can see in the lungs and also in the tissues. In the lungs, the bond between hemoglobin and oxygen is very much, but in the tissues, it is not like that. Oxygen is dissociated. Here, Hb plus O2 become HbO2 means oxyhemoglobin. How many? 4. So, like this, 4 we wrote. But here we should not. We should separate them. So, automatically that hemoglobin can able to release oxygen. How much? That is 22% oxygen delivered. How much oxygen is delivered? 22% out of 97. Out of 97, 22% is delivered all the time in the tissues where oxygen partial pressure is 40 mmHg. Okay, now so like that oxygen and also the hemoglobin relation, if you plot, this is all about oxyhemoglobin dissociation curve. What is the title you have to apply here? Oxyhemoglobin dissociation curve. Oxyhemoglobin dissociation curve, we can also use the word. So, here is y-axis, here is x-axis, this is x-axis, this is y-axis. So, when the blood is coming to the lungs, the graph will go up. When it is going the tissues, the graph will go towards x-axis. Understood? In the lungs, it is coming towards y-axis. So, like that, the oxyhemoglobin relation depends on the partial pressures, temperatures and pH. In the tissues, carbon dioxide is more. That's why hemoglobin and oxygen separated. In the lungs, carbon dioxide is less. So, they are united. Means what? Carbon dioxide and H plus ions are influencing the bond between hemoglobin and oxygen. If there is more carbon dioxide, they are separated. If there is less carbon dioxide, they are united. So influence of, here we have a nice strategy that is all about Bohr effect. Bohr effect. What is Bohr effect? Yes, carbon dioxide, presence of carbon dioxide. What is this? Presence of carbon dioxide and H plus ions influencing. What are these? This is influencing the bond between hemoglobin and oxygen. So this type of influence is called Bohr effect. So one of the important point in the oxygen transportation. Okay, dear students, you understood very well, I think. So here you see the graph, and here also you can see the graph. How much it is delivered means it is only delivered 22%. 75% always it retains with hemoglobin. Why? Because we cannot expect the next movement. Suppose in next movement we couldn't get oxygen in emergency situation, that 75% oxygen is used in the emergency for 3 to 4 minutes to save our lives. Suppose a person is moving with very maximum speed, rapidly he is doing action or rapid exercise he is doing, at that time it will give more than the 60%, but again 35% it retains. So never completely hemoglobin can deliver entire oxygen. It will be stored for the next 2 to 3 minutes or 3 to 4 minutes, depending on the situation. So this is the relation what we discussed about hemoglobin and oxygen. Carbon dioxide is transported in three methods. One is dissolved condition. This is only 7%. And another one is carboxyhemoglobin in this form. It is transported 23%, and all around you can take 20 to 25%. The middle number, that is 23%, and remaining in the form of bicarbonates, that is 70%. So maximum amount of carbon dioxide is transported back to lungs, then to out in the form of bicarbonates. So anyway, in the elimination process, three methods are there in the dissolved condition. So first we will see the dissolved condition. So where it is dissolved? Right, in the plasma water. What is this? Plasma water. In our blood, plasma is there, you know. Okay, so the 55%. So in that plasma, water is there, you know, 92%. In the plasma, how much water is there? 92% water is there. So carbon dioxide can easily dissolve in the plasma water. 20 to 25% carbon dioxide is more dissolved when comparing with oxygen. So that's why, so easily plasma water receives carbon dioxide, because carbon dioxide have highly solubility, and here, from here it will go to that, become, it is going to form H2CO3, and again it is going to get separated. So like that, it's a reversible action. So plasma water is going to get react with carbon dioxide, it will form this type of compound. Okay, then this H2CO3 is unstable, and again it is going to become carbon dioxide and water. Why not fully, only 7%? Why only you mentioned 7%? If it will do like that, the blood acidity increases. If more carbon dioxide dissolved in plasma, our blood will become soda. You know the meaning of soda? Water, which is dissolved with carbon dioxide. So that's why our pH will come down to 3, then we will die. So that's why even though chance is there, but the carbon dioxide never takes more steps towards this type of action, that is only restricted. Anyway, so this is all about plasma water, which can able to react with carbon dioxide to form H2CO3. Next thing, carbamino. Why? Because you can see carbamino compounds in the form of carbamino compounds. Okay, earlier wrote carboxyhemoglobin or carbamino hemoglobin. We can also write like this also. Carbamino is a generally used word. So that's why we mentioned again. So here, this is all about only 23%. Why I wrote amino? Because only amino group can able to receive. Amino group can able to receive, that is called amine group, can able to receive carbon dioxide. So that's why finally in the hemoglobin, amine group can able to, NH2, you can see NH2 group is can able to receive. For oxygen, ferrous group received oxygen, but here carbon dioxide. So this carbon dioxide is going to react with hemoglobin, especially to which part? Just amine part. So like that, amine group can able to bind, and finally it is going to give, so this is the mechanism, you can see. So like that, so the carbon dioxide is going out in this way, but it is very little amount. Here you are observing the picture. This is all related to the 70% transport of CO2. Here you can see as bicarbonate ions. This is the step number 3. Almost 70% of carbon dioxide is, 70% of the carbon dioxide is transported through this method. Now, so how it is, let us see. Yes, here you see in this picture, from the cell metabolism, carbon dioxide released. In the tissues, oxygen is used. What is comes out? Yes, carbon dioxide comes out. Oxygen is used, carbon dioxide is released. This carbon dioxide, where? In the tissues. This carbon dioxide is going to get into the red blood cells. Imagine that this is RBC. What is this? Red blood cell. So from the tissues, what is released? Carbon dioxide. This carbon dioxide is now entering into RBC and reacts with RBC water. The carbon dioxide which is entered, that is reacted with water which is present in the RBC, with the help of fastest enzyme, carbonic anhydrase. What is the fastest enzyme? Carbonic anhydrase. With that, it will form as it is H2CO3. But this H2CO3 is unstable, so this H2CO3 is going to divide H+ and HCO3-. See here, CO2 entered into RBC, reacted with the water which is present inside the RBC with the help of carbonic anhydrase, it form H2CO3, right? This H2CO3 is not stable, so this H2CO3 again divided into HCO3- and H+. Now these H+ ions, see here, these H+ ions are going to receive by hemoglobin. This H plus ions are going to received by hemoglobin. So I am writing that H plus ions received by hemoglobin. Now the hemoglobin is engaged with this H plus ion. Now it will become
HHB. Why H plus ion received by the hemoglobin? If it is not happened, what is going to be? Yes, H plus ions number increases, automatically pH value becomes down, acidity increases. To prevent, to make the balance in the pH, to maintain the buffer, to prevent the reduction in the pH, hemoglobin receives that H plus ion. Hemoglobin has a special protein called histidine. What is present? Histidine. That histidine is very much useful to maintain buffer. So that's why hemoglobin receives H plus ions. But now who left out? HCO3. Like that, many HCO3s accumulate in the RBC. These HCO3 ions comes out. Where they are coming out? Plasma. See, in this form it went in this form it came out. In the form of carbon dioxide it went into, in the form of SCO3 minus ion, bicarbonate ion, like that it came out. So negative ion comes out. Instead of that, which will go to balance this? Chlorine ion will go. This is called chloride shift, hamburger phenomena, chloride shift. One is coming out, another one is going in. This is called a chloride shift. Another name is hamburger phenomena. So like that, carbon dioxide now secretly went into HB, that is RBC, and finally came out like bicarbonate. Okay, so this is the reaction you can see here. Okay, so HCO3 coming out and the chlorine is going. This is called a chloride shift. Now, the reaction reverse. This HCO3 is going back to lungs. What is going to happen in the lungs, we will see. Same situation, reverse scene. Now we are going to get it. So, again, in the lungs, imagine that this is RBC. Okay, now, you know very well, in lungs whose domination is there? Oxygen domination is there. So immediately when the oxygen enters into RBC, HHB, you know this, already hemoglobin is engaged, no? That HHB releases H plus ions and becomes free. So inside there was engagement, but here no such. It is automatically, what happened? The bond between the hemoglobin and H plus will break. Now the hemoglobin will become free. This hemoglobin receives oxygen and becomes oxyhemoglobin. So its job is over. But what about H plus ions? Their number increases. They reacts with HCO3 minus bicarbonates and finally becomes H2O and CO2. Simply I will write H2CO3 and later it will become H2O and CO2. They goes out. Out. What are going out? H2O and CO2. So here which ions are going into? Bicarbonates. Again you should come back. Chlorine. Whatever the reaction we observed here, that is completely opposite in the lungs. You see, I will show you in the picture. You see, here in the lungs, you see, HCO3 is going in, chlorine is coming out. This HCO3 is going to react with H plus ions and automatically it is going out. So here in this picture we brought about the fate of oxygen also here. And also here you can see, what is this? this matter also we can see. So see, reverse chloride shift you are observing. Here chloride shift, here reverse chloride shift. Okay, so like that, the whatever the SCO3 came out, they went into, and chlorine will comes out, reacts with that old friend. What is that? H plus. So again, here also the important role played by carbonic anhydrase enzyme. Same reaction here also, carbonic anhydrase. Here also carbonic anhydrase. Carbonic anhydrase enzyme is the fastest enzyme which is present mostly in the RBC, little amount present in the plasma also. Okay, so like that, carbon dioxide will go out. This is all about carbon dioxide transport. Okay, here you can see chloride shift. There you can see reverse chloride shift. Understood? So it's a very easy. Inside the RBC, the reactions are going on. Here, the first photo explains about tissues, means here. Second photo explains about the lungs, which is here. Here, oxygen is coming, carbon dioxide and water is going out. So this is about respiratory control. So how respiration controlled in our body? So what are the parts present in our brain? So how they will control this respiration, we will see now. This is one of the interesting topic. Here you see, so in the brain, there are the centers, the specially mentioned centers you can see. Imagine that, okay, this is all about the brain. Okay, and this is the important parts related to our topic. You see, this is pons. Okay, and this is medulla. So see here, in this picture also you can see clearly, this is the part what you are observing, pons, and this is the part medulla. So these parts you can see here, the zoomed, here it is. This is pons and this is medulla. So here also this is pons and this is medulla. So like that, pons and medulla, two are very important. First we will see the medulla. Right, in the medulla, RRC, the word I am using, RRC, respiratory rhythm center. RRC means respiratory rhythm center. This respiratory rhythm center consists of two small parts. One is dorsal respiratory and ventral respiratory. Dorsal part and ventral part are present. These two, one will do the inspiration and another one is for expiration. So like that, RRC centers, which are dorsally ventrally located, one will do the inspiration and another one will do the expiration. Okay, they will do the necessary adjustments for breathing. It is a involuntary action. Why? Because you know, medulla oblongata will do the involuntary activities. And near to that, a small center is there, chemosensory center. What is this? Chemosensory center. Chemosensory center. Okay. And in the pons, you can see pneumotoxic center. Pneumotoxic center. Pneumotoxic center. In this picture, you can see clearly, you see pneumotoxic center is there. Anneustic center is there. These two together we can call respiratory centers in the pons. Respiratory centers in the pons. Okay. Anneustic, pneumotoxic, anneustic. What is this? We will see now. In the pneumotoxic center, suppose if any venom entered into our blood, for example, snake bite, etc. So it will going to get the damage to the respiratory center. Or else in a chemistry laboratory, for example, we expose it to some toxic gases. Suddenly we should run out from that area. After that, what will be your action? You will do like this. What is this? Deep breathing. Deep breathing. within no time you will do many respirations. Rate of breathing increases, depth of breathing also increases, the gap between the inspiration and inspiration decreases. So like that, in the emergency situations we will do more deep breathing within less time, many number of breathings, duration between the inspiration and inspiration decreases, and also the depth of breathing increases. Okay, just now I saw, okay, you saw the action like that. So this is the action in emergency situations to make the human normal, to replace the situations normally. These are going to happen because of pneumotoxic center. Anaustic center is also the same thing. Till we will get the oxygen properly, till the time that type of actions will be there, that type of sense is there to that particular pons region. Coming to medulla region, coming to this part, you can see this is a very important region. Okay, medullary respiration. Medullary respiration, a chemosensory area is also there. Chemosensory is the area also, almost it works with the pons and also works with the medulla. Why? Because we can imagine that pneumotoxic, the word itself, it is there, the toxic. Here you can say chemo, so almost same. So almost that area is not yet mentioned in the diagram, but this is the center which is almost present near to the pons and also between the pons and medulla. Right, coming to the respiratory rhythm center, here another thing is there. Not only this chemosensory center is going to sense the carbon dioxide and H plus ions. What the chemosensory area is going to do? Chemosensory center, which is present very near to the RRC, present very near to the RRC and respiratory rhythm center. If in our body carbon dioxide level and H plus ions level increased in our blood, immediately it will send a signal to RRC to do the necessary adjustments. And there is a special center, you can see in our blood vessels. You see this diagram of our heart, you know, these are the largest vessel that you can see, systemic aorta. This systemic aorta also, you see, this is a dorsal aorta. This is a carotid branch which is going towards head, which is going towards body parts. Even this area also, you see in the dots, these areas also very much sensitive, dorsal aorta and carotid. Why? Because they always carry oxygenated blood. What type of blood is passing? Always oxygenated blood. But if carbon dioxide level increased, if H plus ions level increased, if carbon dioxide level increased, if H plus ions level increased, immediately this dorsal aorta and carotid branch gets the sensation, the receptors are present. From here to there, there is a nerve connection. From here to here, what is this? There is a neural connection is there. So because of that, these two blood vessels sends a signal to respiratory rhythm center, especially in the medullary respiratory center, to do the necessary adjustments for getting the normal conditions. Okay, so generally, suppose if you take 100 ml of oxygenated blood, okay, in that only 5 ml delivered to the tissues. So that's why we are breathing continuously. Okay, in between we are not taking any rest. Why? Because see the situation here, in the lungs it will looks 100 ml, but when coming to the tissues, how much is delivered? Only 5 ml. So that's why continuously we have to breathe. Same like that, how much carbon dioxide is eliminated? If you see 100 ml CO2 in the tissues, 100 ml CO2
How much is delivered? That is only 4 ml is going out. How much CO2 is going out of 100 ml? Only 4 ml.
So that's why here you can see there is a difference. Continuously carbon dioxide should go out, continuously oxygen should come in. So generally you will see one type of respiratory reaction, you can see yawning. You know yawning? We will do like that. What is the definition of yawning? Yawning means forceful inspiration. Why you are yawning? You are taking the air into your lungs with maximum force to compensate the lack of oxygen in your body. So like that, that is one of the involuntary adaptation, involuntary reaction which is done by the medulla. Understood? So like that it is there. Okay, generally how many times we can breathe? Tell me how many times we can breathe? We can breathe only 12 times. As an adult, we have how many breathings are there? 12 times breathing per minute. Okay, it is more in the children. Okay, and the difference in the different persons, but normally we can say 12 to 15 times breathing is a normal breathing. Okay. So this is all about respiratory rhythm center. So how many times the breathing should be there? How, in which time the breathing should increase? In which time the breathing should decrease? So that all the adjustments are going to done this particular part. Pons respiratory centers and medullary respiratory centers, together called respiratory control centers. The next part of this lesson, this is all about lung capacity. Okay, so this is, we can also called lung capacity. Depending on the volumes, how much air we can inhale, how much air we can exhale, that amount we will see in the form of this graph. You see this line. See, generally you can say I am putting four lines here, four parts. Okay, one I can say that it is a TV, tidal volume. One is inspiratory reserve volume, and another one is expiratory reserve volume, and this is always residual volume. These are the four volumes you can see. Okay, what is this? IRV, TV, ERV, RV. These are the volumes. You see, V, you observed. IRV, inspiration. TV, tidal volume. ERV, expiratory. E means expiration. I means inspiration. That's all. This is residual volume. What is that? We will see now. See first. Here same, 1, 2, 3, 4. Here also in this graph also you can see 4. Here also you can see. So here it is there. Now here I will explain why this graph came. Now let us see this wave, the central wave, what you are observing, this is normal breathing. Okay, so from here to here you can see normal breathing. You released air out. What is this down? You came down. Down means released air, expirated. Then inspirated, then normal, then inspirated, then normal. So like that, these are the things you are observing. But according to this, we will see now. You see, inspiration, inspiration, right? Inhalation, exhalation. Observe me carefully. This is all about normal breathing. But what I did, you know, what is this? Means air is coming out. So this is the way. So first TV, tidal volume. How much tidal volume? This is all about 500 ml. Suppose you are in rest. The amount of air is going in. The amount of air is coming out. This is how much? 500 ml. Inspiration, expiration. Inspiration, expiration. But now what I did? More than that, I released. So this is all about
ERV, expiration. How much I can do? More than that, 1000 to, okay, 1100 ml. Generally, I will do. So, expiratory reserve volume. Roughly, I can take 100 ml. Means, 1000 ml. Means, 1 liter. Normal breathing, 500 ml. Forcefully.
Okay, so, at the time of birthday, generally, you have to, okay, close the candle means, you will do, no? This type of thing, you can say it is a ERV. Okay, but how much force you can do the exhalation, but you cannot do the empty of your lungs. It never happens. Always in our lungs, there will be 1200 ml, always in our lungs. Even after death also, there will be some volume of air is in our lungs. So, how much forcefully you can apply to eliminate the air? You cannot empty your lungs. Why? Because this is the volume which is always present in the lungs in a normal person. Okay? This is residual volume. This is residual volume. From here, you can take the air up. See here, after emptying and after forceful expiration, I never becomes, okay, empty. Why? Because RV never, always will be there in lungs. So, after forceful expiration, the amount of air inhalated from here to here, it is called vital capacity. From here to here, we can call it as a vital capacity. Vital capacity. From here to here, this is expiratory capacity. Expiratory capacity. Here it is vital capacity. Normally, how much you can breathe? 500 ml. Now, how much addition to 500? How much you released out? 1000. 500 plus 1000 total expiratory capacity. Only if you take only this box, 1000 ml. Together, if you take from here to here, you can take both. That will become 1500, right? So, this is 1500 E capacity, expiratory capacities. If you add two together, that is called capacities. If you take only one, that is called volumes. Now, you can see after forceful expiration, see my action. Means the amount of air which is inspirated, more than that inspirated. So, this inspiration is vital capacity. After this, again we will come back to tidal volume. What is this? Again TV. Okay, so come this way. We will travel in this way. Tidal volume. What is this? I'm going up. Going up means IRV. Where I am, in which chamber I am going? I am going to this way. So, IRV. How much air I can, IRV? How much volume I can able to inspire? Nearly 3000 ml. See, this is normal. What I did? Extra air added to my lungs along with this. Okay, so this is ERV. Together, if you add both, from here to here, if you add, how much it will be? This is 3000, this is 500. Total 3500. About inspiratory capacity. See here, you can see capacity. Three times we added the capacity words here. So, again, after forceful inhalation, the amount of air which is released out is also called vital capacity. If you go down like this, you will get vital capacity. If you come up like this also, you will get vital capacity. If you go down, if you come up, this is all. If you want to say like this, if you want to say like this, no problem. This is all about vital capacity. Understood? Okay. Now, normally, you are not doing anything. Normally, you are sitting. At this time, this is called
normal functional residual capacity. What is this? FRC, functional residual capacity.
This is the story. Functional residual capacity means this is there. You are not doing like this. You are simply breathing. So where you are moving? Here only you are moving. Your breathing is here only.
Tidal value. If you do forceful expiration, it come down to ERV. But you are not doing anything. So automatically these two volumes, if you add,
that will be functional residual capacity. But always in our lungs, what is present in a normal healthy person? Residual volume. These volumes are counted by, okay, special, that is spirometer. What is this? Spirometer. This is a special type of machine that can able to count the volume of breath, what we can inhale or exhale, to get the perfectness of our lungs. How much it is perfect, is any problem is there in our, because of that the pulmonologist can able to detect the diseases, the abnormalities especially. That is all about the volumes. Okay, now we understood. Now once again, IRV, TV, ERV, IRV. TV is 500 ml, IRV is 3000 ml, capacity of ERV is 1000 ml, RV is always 1100 to 1200 ml. If you add, you will get. Okay, this is these four together. What you can say, these four together? Total lung capacity. Together, plus, 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 plus. Together called total lung capacity. Okay, simply you can write. Total lung capacity means all the time plus, 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 four times, you no need to add. If you take VC, three boxes are covering. RV, one box is covering. So, simply you can write VC plus RV. So, that is all about the volumes. I think you understood very well about this graph particularly. Okay, you see, you take from here to here, that is enough to read. Okay, this is all about lung capacities. Respiratory disorders. Respiratory disorders. So now we can see the respiratory disorders, different types. First thing is asthma. Generally in the metro cities, if you observe, lot of pollution is there, vehicle pollution, or else on the road dust is there. So because of that, most of the people, especially in the metro cities, they will get respiratory problems because of this dust and pollution. So what is going to happen in this asthma? Generally the asthma patients, you can see, this is the bronchi and bronchioles. So in the bronchi and bronchioles, smooth muscles get show spasms. What are these smooth muscles? What is going to happen to smooth muscles? They are contracted. For such a long time they will show contraction. So automatically the lumen become narrow. The air may not pass clearly through the lungs. So that's why a type of wheezing sound. So like that, a small wheezing sound we can see. And also they will face problem. Like that, at the time of breathing. You may observe so many people in our surrounding areas especially. So they will get asthma. Okay, it is a common respiratory disorder. Why? Because of that allergy also we will get this. Okay, so allergy, histamine, like that some products are released. So generally asthma is there. This is all about constriction. We can also see spasms. The word is there. Spasm means prolonged muscle contraction is called spasm. So like that the breathing problem will come. Especially, okay, in children we can see this asthma condition. Next one is bronchitis. bronchitis, bronchi. Generally in the bronchi, there is a lot of mucus accumulations are there. What is this? Lot of mucus accumulation is there. So because of that inflammation, we can also call mucus accumulation is there, and inflammation of bronchi is called bronchitis. And the third one is emphysema. I am putting star for this. Okay, why? I will tell you now. Emphysema. This is a chronic respiratory disease. Why? Because especially who is smoking tobacco? What is this? Smoking tobacco. So this is the problem. Okay, continuously he is smoking tobacco. The alveoli in the lungs. You know, small bags are there in our lungs. Alveoli. These alveoli wall, you see now, these alveoli wall will get dissolved. That is colasque, breakage of walls. What is the colasque? Breakage of the alveolar walls. Because of that, what happens? Alveoli number decreases. You see in this. So what happened before that? Many alveoli are there. Now you see in this diagram. There is a few alveoli, you can see. Respiratory surface area decreases. Before that, there lot of area is there. But because of this cigarette smoke, the area decreased due to the damage of walls. So that's why emphysema problem is there. Breathing problem will come. Sometimes lung cancer also we can see there. That is emphysema. Okay. Last and final, generally pneumonia. What is this? Pneumonia. This pneumonia is caused by bacteria. Haemophilus influenza. Streptococcus pneumonia. What are that? Streptococcus pneumonia. Haemophilus influenza. These two bacterias are going to cause pneumonia. Generally, this is one of the dangerous diseases. Why? Because in the respiratory tract and in the alveoli, lot of water and mucus accumulated. So our lungs filled with water and mucus. And the pipe is also, bronchi, bronchioles pipes are also filled with water and mucus. So respiratory problem will come. Sometimes death may also happen. So pneumonia is a very dangerous disease in the respiration. And not only that, another simple diseases we can see. Okay, cold. You know the meaning of cold? I think everyone in their lifetime compulsory affected with cold. Anybody is there without cold? No, compulsory everyone, they are going to get the experience of cold. What is the full form of cold, you know? Generally, we will use the word cold. Common obstructive lung disease. What is full form? Common obstructive lung disease. Common obstructive lung disease. Generally, it will not get any problem. Why? Because this is a special type of virus. Rhinovirus is there. There are many groups of rhinoviruses is there. Its lifetime is only 1 week. Within 1 week, it will complete its work, its life cycle, and finally it will go out. So that's why if you take the tablet, if you do not take the tablet, it will be there with you for 1 week. Maximum 1 week, minimum 4 to 5 days. So like that, it is their common obstructive disease, but it is not going to get to the lungs. It is only going to get only up to the upper respiratory tract. It never goes to trachea and it never goes to lungs. Some type of industries, lot of particulate matter which is going to get inhalated into the lungs. That dust never settles. Always it will be there, it will float in the air. So that inhalation causes occupational disorders. Occupation means job. Occupational disorders. through job these type of diseases they will get. First thing I can say, siderosis. Okay, so this is all about, so first we will see about the best disease, that is coal mine. The people who are working in the coal mines, they will get black lung disease. What is this? Black lung disease. The people who can inhale coal dust. So lot of black color that will comes out from the coals. So they will inhale. What is that disease? Black lung disease. Number two, bicinosis. Bicinosis. Generally, the people who can inhale cotton dust, fabric industry, there will lot of cotton dust will come. So from that, bicinosis we can see. The disease is called cotton dust, that because of that cotton dust, bicinosis will get. So their lungs are blocked with this type of cotton. Especially in the fabric industries, we can see that bicinosis. The number three, asbestosis. Asbestosis. Asbestos industry, generally cement industry. You know cement dust, generally we will see. So lot of dust comes out when you open the cement bag. So this dust in the industry that causes lot of problem to the workers who are there. They are going to get the problem with the cement dust. Cement dust, that is asbestosis. Okay, the next one is siderosis. Okay, so siderosis generally, that is iron industry. Okay, so that is hemoferrosis. Okay, siderosis, this is one type of disease. So these are the different types of diseases are going to get occupational disorders. So we completed respiratory system and we discussed about the lung volumes, transportation of gases, and finally about these occupational disorders.